You may be seated. One of the most difficult things for the American church to grasp is the fact that persecution is indeed going on in the church. We have become so comfortable being able to go to and fro, to be able to drive to church in our air-conditioned cars, and I thank God for it. Well, on a day-to-day like today, I thank God that it's heated, and some of us have remote start, and we can hit a button, and the car heats up before we ever get out there, and Lord have mercy. Thank you, Jesus, for technology. But I'm going to tell you, there's persecution against the church in the world that is coming under great intensity. One of the reasons that it's so difficult for us to understand is our freedoms. When we look from another standpoint, I'm not so sure that the American church isn't going through a soft persecution that has been harmful to us. The devil is evil and he's wicked, but he's also smart. He's incredibly smart. Don't you underestimate the devil, because he is wise. And for persecution in America to work, he cannot attack like he does in other countries. In other countries, he's bold, but here in America, he comes up very subtly. And kind of like in the Garden of Eden. Persecution of the American church shows up in a variety of different ways. Comes up in a low level of desire for holiness. Comes up with us just wanting to barely get by. Well, what's the least I have to do to be pleasing to God? Instead of, how can I please God today? How can I just get by? An alarming lack of spiritual discernment. Look, we have to be wise. We have to have that spiritual discernment to know who is for us and who is against us. We have to know what spirits people are carrying, lest we be affected by them ourselves. My goodness. Worship is sorely lacking in seriousness. I get so upset when I see people who are very flippant in worship. When I see a ball game being played and I see people screaming until they have no more voice and it's so intense, but then we come to church and we're like, God is not pleased with that. But I'm going to tell you, when you come in the I feel the Holy Ghost right now. When you come in the presence of God and your hands are outstretched and your focus is solely on Him, not on your checkbook, not on where we're going to eat. Well, that's important because I'm hungry, but your focus has to be on Him. And I'm afraid in the American church that we've lost that. Well, I'm going to tell you, Brother Mooney, yesterday I got to hear him preach to my son a little bit. And my Lord, I was in the congregation too. And he said, you know, I'm so sick. This is what Brother Mooney said. And I agree with him wholeheartedly. And y'all have heard me preach this, so it's nothing new. He said, I'm so sick of churches turning the lights out in the sanctuary and putting stage lights on. I would to God that we switch that around and we turn the stage lights off and we turn the lights out on in the sanctuary so people can worship. Let's take the focus off of the singer and put it back on praise and worship. Let's do that for a while. Let's please God for a while. I'm going to tell you, I looked at my son afterwards. I said, I'm jealous of you. My Lord, he preached to them young people because he wants to make sure this next generation doesn't lose God. We've come to a generation where, I'm getting ahead of myself, where there's soaring biblical illiteracy. How many of us have ever encountered somebody who don't know basic Bible stories? I'm going to tell you, when I was running the bus route, it was amazing to me how many children didn't even know who Noah was. They had no idea some of the basic Bible stories, nothing about it, because subtly the world has drowned it out. And the devil uses all types of things. He uses media. He uses social media. How many of us use social media? Come on, I'm not going to call you out because I use it too. I hate this generation where you look at a dinner table and everybody's doing this. I'm guilty of it. I have to make a point to either leave my phone in the car if we're out to eat, or leave my phone in another room so I'm not tempted to pick it up. It grabs a hold of you. Brother Arms taught the young people a lesson a while back, and there was a certain way you can look at your phone and you can tell where you spend the most time. And Facebook had it, didn't it? People always wanted to, well, what did so-and-so have for dinner today? Oh my goodness, that's so important. Oh, look at that outfit. No, we need to put our thought processes and our focus on godly things. But that's how the American church is being persecuted. We don't even know it. Some would say that this is not persecution, but the way that soft persecution comes is through the gates of materialism, consumerism, and carnal attitudes. Persecution at its very evil root is satanic, as just a glance of our reading has proved to us. According to the Open Doors organization that keeps track of Christian persecution around the world, the top 25 nations that persecute Christians, the majority now are in the Middle East, and we kind of assume that, right? What becomes more sobering is a report that they did in August of last year that now ISIS has recruited children who are now executing adult Christians. We're talking 8, 9, 10-year-olds carrying guns, killing Christians. They're called cubs. This is the world that we live in. We are so sheltered in America that we do not see this. Now, we've seen a little bit whenever ISIS broadcast the beheading of some, but that pales in comparison to what's really going on. We are very sheltered. And I'm telling you, the end of the world is coming quicker than we think. Jesus' return is coming quicker than we think. And we have to be ready. We cannot be consumed by this world. We cannot be consumed by the things of this world, but we have to make sure that we have Jesus in focus. Now, Jesus gave us some promises before the persecution. In light of the coming persecution, Jesus made it very clear that it would take place. John 16, 1 through 3. These things have I spoken unto you, that you should not be offended. They shall put you out of the synagogues. They're going to kick you out of church. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he's doing God a service. I'm going to tell you, that sounds like the ISIS movement where they're trying to kill infidels. Let me tell you, in their eyes, we are infidels. In their eyes, they're doing God a service whenever they kill us. So Jesus was right on it, not that I've ever thought that he wasn't. And these things they will do unto you because they have not known the Father. This is just one of his warnings that he left. And through the Gospels, there are other messages that he left. However, there are New Testament warnings that are given as well. 2 Timothy 3 and 12 says this, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. That's not given. It's not you might suffer persecution. He's real direct. He says you're going to be persecuted. It's going to be tough for you. You're going to have hard times. When Peter was writing his epistles, he warned of persecution in chapters 2, 3, 4, and 5. All that are godly are going to suffer persecution. But he sums up what will happen in 1 Peter 5 and 10. And that says this, but the God of all grace, who hath called us into his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. Persecution is going to come. We are part of the persecuted church. I'm going to tell you, there's so many people that stand against the church and think that we're heresies. And I'm getting ahead of myself because this happened years ago too, in Jesus' day. But we have to stand strong. And when we stand strong, God is going to strengthen us. He's going to give us the courage and faith to endure. We can't just bolt at the first sign of trouble. Matthew 16 and 18 says this, "And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Now look, this scripture gets all twisted up even by Pentecostal churches. So let me explain to you what exactly he's saying here. It does not mean that someone can charge hell with a water pistol. It does not. I feel that way sometimes. There's sometimes I walk out of this place, you give me two squirt guns and a backpack of water, and we're good. We're gonna take over. But that's not what this means. The true meaning is that the gates of Hades, the gates of death, will not prevail against the church. The enemies of the church, even Satan himself, can physically kill the church members, but he cannot kill the church, regardless of what comes or what goes. This truth is going on, and the church will go on. And if we will stay faithful, God will give us a crown of life. It's so amazing to me, and if you know, this may be a deal breaker for some of you guys. I know it's really funny to me, because in a lot of churches, what I'm about to address is a deal breaker. Some churches are pre-trib, some are mid-trib, and some are post-trib. I'm believing post-trib. There's several reasons I believe that, and this isn't in my notes, and I apologize. He gave us the parable of the wise and foolish virgins. They didn't have enough oil to make the journey. We got to make sure that we are prepared for whatever may come. We got to make sure that we have enough oil in us that if persecution lasts a while, that we can endure it. And I'm going to tell you, if the disciples, if the apostles suffered in their time, why would we not suffer now? I'm going to tell you, we better be ready. So if you were wondering what my stance is on that, I'm post-trib. So I hope that isn't a deal breaker for anybody in here. If you still love your pastor, say amen. Amen. Whew, that was good. Persecution will never destroy a church, but it will strengthen that church. I'm going to tell you, whatever you're going through, I'm going to give you the title of this sermon I'm going to preach soon. Your affliction will lead to your addition. The more that you're afflicted, the more you're going to grow, honey. I'm going to tell you, the first time I ever went to a gym and I got on that, I got that barbell out and I lifted up like that. I got off of the weights. I remember I was lifting for football and I went to the locker room. And I tried to put my shirt on and I couldn't. I was crying. I was literally tears. But after a while, I started getting the muscles. It came through affliction. I had to afflict those muscles to build them. And I became stronger. And when we're afflicted as a church, we become stronger. And I know that under the sound of my voice that this year, this church, I don't think anybody's excluded from this, has suffered affliction. You better thank God, because that means that you are going the right way and that God found you worthy and that he found you, that you would be strong enough to make it. It doesn't ever feel like that we can make it. How many of us have been in the midst of a trial where you thought it was going to be the end? Where you cry at night and you wonder, God, how long? But it's at that time that God's got you right in the palm of his hand and he's building you. My goodness. Smyrna is one of the churches that was under the harshest conditions of persecution. The Lord has a word for the church, and there's not a hint of rebuke in it. Smyrna and Philadelphia are the only two churches that the Lord does not find anything at fault. I'm going to tell you, how many of us, and I'll be the first one to admit, I'll raise my hand before I ask you, how many of us in the midst of your trial thought, God, what did I do wrong? God, what's wrong with me? Did I do something to hurt you? God, I'm sorry. But it's in that he's just building, you see. If you're being persecuted, God loves you. He chastises those that he loves. You know, the world's got it wrong. Kids, look up here real quick. I want you kids, Travis. Yeah, all of you. I'm missing Ethan tonight. Where's Ethan? Home, okay. Let me tell you kids something. How many of us does mom and dad get on us? time or two, they might spank our little backsides, right? You better thank God for a mom and dad that loves you enough to correct you. You better thank God for a mama and papa that will put the padded glove down and give you a little discipline, because that means they love you. They want to see you do well. They want to see you succeed. They want you to do better. And that comes through correction. You show me a kid that's never had correction in their life, and I'll show you a child that has some problems. Amen, amen. To a certain degree, all the churches were under a degree of persecution, and it had affected them. Ephesus lost their first love. Pergamos decided they were going to tolerate false doctrine. I'm going to tell you, we don't tolerate false doctrine. There's one way to God, and that's Jesus Christ. Repentance, baptism in Jesus' name, and being filled with the Holy Ghost. One faith, one Lord, one baptism. Thyatira, there was a presence of rampant and unrepentant sin in the church. We cannot, look, there are going to be sinners come here. And you know what? I thank God for every one of them. And we are going to love them. We are going to love them, and we're going to let God work in their lives. We are not going to line anybody out. Amen. How many of us did God take his time with us and was very gentle with us, and he loved us? That's how God works. Let's let God do the work in these sinners' lives that are coming. Amen. Because God is getting ready to fill this place with people who are hurting, that are bringing baggage. And, you know, it will be addressed. God will address it, whether it's through the preaching or whether it's in their personal devotion time. But God will address it. The best thing that we can do is love those people. Sardis, another church that had allowed sin to destroy them. And Laodicea, a church that had become totally apostate. The clear progressiveness of the destruction of these churches is seen moving from Ephesus to Laodicea. Last week I mentioned the further away they got from Ephesus, the worse they became. The further away you get from the word, the worse the church is going to become. That's why we must be planted in the word of God. Every sermon must come straight from the word of God. It's not good enough for me to get up here and tell us a little story and a joke and make us laugh and go home. But we have to have the word of God in every service. We got to have that word planted in our heart. And we have to stay true to the apostolic doctrine. Revelation 2, 8, A and B. Unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, we come to the church in Smyrna that is the second one on the postal route in Asia Minor. It was about 30 miles north of Ephesus and was situated on a great harbor. During the times of war, the harbor could be completely enclosed so that it was a strong defense of the city. While much of Christianity has grown lifeless and ritualistic in Turkey, there are still small pockets of believers there today. They do not face the persecution of Caesar now. Instead, they have to be aware of the attack of Islamic followers. And I'm going to tell you, I was kind of surfing Facebook the other day, and there's a gentleman that I'm friends with that posts some of the persecution that's going on in other countries. And I watched this Islamic fellow walk up to this young teenage girl, and because she was not dressed according to what he thought she should wear, he slapped her right in the middle of public, and nobody did a thing. My Lord, Sister Deborah, I'd be lying if I said I didn't get a little worked up. My blood pressure raised just a little bit. But I'm going to tell you, this was over in the Netherlands. She was being persecuted because she was a Christian. It came out later that she was a Christian. I'm telling you, we are going to be persecuted. We are going to be persecuted. Revelations 2:8c, the counselor steps in and he says, he saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. The Lord will identify himself in the opening of every one of these letters. And this description that he gives certainly should not be strange to us. The Lord, which was dead and is alive, resounded with the believers at Smyrna because they knew that Jesus had died on the cross but was resurrected. And he was made perfect. He was justified. The Lord is drawing them back to the cross where the most intense pain and suffering of the Lord is present. The Lord wants the believers at Smyrna to know that he's experienced the suffering that led to death. They should take encouragement from that because the Lord has already tasted the first fruits of death and is victorious over death, hell, and the grave. Whatever we're going through today, I want you to compare that to what the Lord suffered. He was betrayed by one of his own disciples. He was beaten beyond recognition. And then he was crucified, and yet he did nothing wrong. It's awful when you're falsely accused, isn't it? Anybody in here been falsely accused, had things said about you that just weren't true? Any of us been beat up for no good reason? Well, maybe it was good reason, but it's just a loss. Why you gotta tell everything? My Lord. No matter how intense your suffering, the Lord will supply great strength to them in tribulation. In Revelation 2:9, he begins to commend them. He begins to tell them, I know you. Watch this. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. Don't think that what you have in this is any indication of where you are with God. That's a lie from the pit if you think that this equates to godliness. I'm going to tell you, am I saying that you can't be rich and be a great Christian? I'm not saying that. But money has nothing to do in your spiritual prosperity. Yeah. Well, I'll just leave that there. I'll let y'all just kind of snack on that for a minute, and I'll keep going. I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews but are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. The commendation that the Lord gives to them almost solely has to do with their persecution. Once again, we have to draw attention to the Lord knowing their works. What does that mean? That means we don't come to this altar and repent. Sorry, Jesus, for everything I've done. I'm turning away. We don't just go back to the back room and get baptized in Jesus' name. That's important. You can't get to heaven without it. Let me say that again. You cannot get to heaven without it. It's not enough just to speak in tongues like a Chinaman. That's the initial evidence of the Holy Ghost. That's the beginning evidence of the Holy Ghost. But after all that, we are not called to hold a seat down. This is not works. This is not works. Works is getting involved. Works is finding where you fit in and get in. That's where that you're reaching out to others. And you know, it's wonderful because everybody is finding their niche. We have those that are in the choir, those that are getting hooked up with the drama team. We got those that are doing the ASR outreach. We've got those that door knock faithfully every time there's door knocking. That's how you get in where you fit in. That's how you do your works. We have Sunday school teachers. My Lord, I believe I've got one of the youngest Sunday school teachers ever, and she is doing a fantastic job. But that's all part of it. That's all part of it. We have to get in. And I'm going to tell you, this isn't in my notes either, and I'm not going to get through this sermon. David was the man after God's own heart. Brother Rex, he did not fall into sin until he quit doing works. It was the day that he sat back and did nothing that he was lured into temptation. I'm going to tell you, when you are idle, that's where the devil's going to step in and say, well, it ain't going to hurt you just to do a little bit of this or a little bit of that. I didn't mean to go here, but here I am. But when you're involved, you don't have time to look at this or look at that or be part of this or be part of that. But when you're actively involved in the church, I know that's a cuss word today. We need to just come and feel the presence of God and go home. No! No! That's not go ye therefore. Who's ye? Ye is me. We got to get involved. If you want to flee youthful lust, go run toward the work of God. Go run toward these things. Get out. Look. I had the opportunity to sit down with a couple of three IBC students and just begin to give them a little bit of knowledge I have. Took all 30 seconds. I told them, I said, the most powerful thing that you'll ever experience in your life is teaching a home Bible study, sitting down and watching somebody receive revelation of God for the first time, watching God grow in their lives, watching God change their lives. That is the most rewarding thing that you'll ever see in your life, knowing that God counted you worthy to work through you. It's amazing. We need to get in where we fit in. You know, I'm going to brag on Brother Craig a little bit. He had no idea I was going to do this, and the deer in the headlight looks assures me of that. Brother Craig, he come to me. You don't mind if I tell this to you? I love you. He come to me. He said, Pastor, I want to be involved. What can I do? My God, my eyes lit up. I bet they about popped out of my head. I was like, well, let me help you out with that. I've got something for you to do. Now, Brother Craig is getting involved with audio, video, and media. He's getting involved in the choir. And you know what? Brother Craig, you're going to watch your walk climb. You're going to see yourself going to places in Jesus that you've never been before because you're involved. How many of us are ready to get involved? Clap your hands to the Lord. Hallelujah. All right, where am I at? He's clear about the necessity of works in every church. There's a great reward that will be received for those who are committed to working for the kingdom of God. Furthermore, there's no way around the fact that established faith will lead to devoted works. If you love God, you're going to want to tell people about it. If you love God and your faith is where it should be, you're going to want people to feel what you feel. Man, I don't take what I've got for granted. When I wake up in the morning, Brother Arms, I feel real good. My foot may hurt a little bit, but I feel real good in my spirit. My body may be getting older, because getting old ain't for sissies. But my spirit, man, I wake up with the joy of the Lord. I don't care what's going on. It can be the worst trial of my life, but knowing that the Lord is on my side and that He's fighting for me, it makes the day go by so much easier. The Lord commends them for their works and for their tribulation. Smyrna was considered to be the greatest city that was devoted to the worship of Caesar. The common greeting in the street was, Caesar is Lord. The Christians would reply, Jesus is Lord. And then they would be persecuted for that. Because Smyrna was loyal to Rome, they had built a temple around 196 BC dedicated to Dea Roma, the goddess of Rome. They actually worshiped the city. And during the time of John's time on Patmos, the Roman Caesar was Domitian, who was a bloodthirsty tyrant who wanted to kill every Christian that he could find. It cannot be without some divine irony that the meaning of the word Smyrna is suffering. It is also not strange from us that the name also comes from the word myrrh. Myrrh is a fragrant sap that comes from a small tree that has a bitter taste to it. The gum tree would be removed by the cutting of the bark of the trunk and of the branches, and the oily sap would ooze out of the markings and drop into small wooden containers and be allowed to solidify. The process of getting the gum out of the tree would cause it to become horribly disfigured. There's some things that we have to face in life. You know, Sister Deborah, I don't understand why I had to go through some of the things I had to go through. Some of us have been through some terrible, terrible circumstances. And it's so funny to me how people outside of the church think that we all came from perfect backgrounds. People outside of the church think that we've always had it together, that we came out of the womb speaking in tongues, filled with the Holy Ghost. People think that we never made a mistake or never had to endure anything. You know, I came from an alcoholic home that I didn't understand. I came from some abusive things that I didn't understand why I had to go through. I didn't understand why I had to have my head beat in at 17 years old and have to wear dentures at 17. I didn't understand that. There was times I got angry with God about it. Now look, there are times where we make choices. The reason that I wear dentures today, that was my choice, let me tell you. It was bad decisions on my part. But all of these things worked together for my good. I would not have the testimony that I have today had it not have been for the disfiguring of my younger days and for the trials of my faith. You know, back when Sister Lawson and I first got married, it wasn't real popular for a young girl to have a baby outside of wedlock. It's kind of frowned upon. But you know what? God stepped in and he made a way. God stepped in the midst of everything going on in our lives, and he brought us to a place where he says, now I can use you. Now you're ready. And we weren't really ready, but we were ready to get in the church, right? And God allowed a process. And just because we come to church, let me make this disclaimer. Just because you come to church, and I hope this lesson brings this out very clearly, it doesn't mean that you're not going to suffer. There is suffering in the church. Smyrna suffered, but God loved them for it. God commended them for it, that they suffered and did not fail. This disfigurement of this tree served as a literal symbol of what suffering does, but it also shows what blessings comes from the wounds. That's exactly what happened to the believers in the city. Myrrh was used for many different purposes. It was used in perfumes as an ingredient for holy anointing oil, for purification of women, for embalming the dead. It was also brought by the wise men to Jesus at his birth. It was brought with gold that was a picture of the Lord's royalty. It was brought with frankincense, which typified his deity and purity. And the myrrh was a picture of his suffering humanity. When the Lord was on his cross, he was offered wine mingled with myrrh that would have acted as a primitive pain reliever. When the Lord comes again, he'll not be presented with myrrh because he's no longer suffering, but he's reigning and he's mighty. He's not on the cross anymore, folks, but he's alive. He's not dead. He's been past that, and he conquered death, hell, and the grave. But in order for myrrh to achieve its full fragrance and perfume, it has to be crushed and beaten. That is exactly what happened to the church in Smyrna. It was crushed, it was beaten, and it was persecuted. Their crushing came from three different sources: tribulation, which literally means pressure. This word is used to describe a man who was tortured to death by slowly being crushed by a big boulder that was laid on him. It was used also to describe the crushing of wheat under a millstone. Jesus was very aware of the threshing that goes on in the life of a child of God. No one is immune from the pain and the struggles of life. Everybody has life struggles. Some put on better facade than the others. Don't fool yourself into thinking that you're the only one being persecuted. That's a lie. That is the voice of the enemy trying to tell you that you're being persecuted just because you're in church. How many of us had trouble outside the church? I'm here to tell you, let me shock some of y'all. Oh, Lord, I hope y'all go to church here after this. There was a time that your pastor went to jail before he was in church. Let me tell you about the struggles of life. As I mentioned before, I had my teeth beat out of my head. There were struggles in life. There was all these things that happened before I came in. We all too often forget about these things. How many of us had some struggles before we came to church? Anybody other than me? My God, I was tied down to some addictions that ruled over me. Man, I can remember waking up in the morning, hacking up a lung. I'd be like, y'all heard the smoker's cough, right? And then I'd roll over to grab another cigarette. And I'm like, what in the... I look back at it, I'm like, stupid, 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 stupid. There are struggles of life, even outside of church. Everybody faces struggles. In the days of the Romans, they would thresh grain by using a cart that was equipped with rollers instead of wheels. Sharp stones and rough bits of iron were attached to these cylinders to separate the husk from the grain. The cart was called a tribulum, which comes from the word tribulation, where when great affliction comes to us, we can sometimes think of ourselves as being torn to pieces by the cruel pressures of adverse circumstances. He knows our tribulation. I can remember many a morning before I got the faith and courage to do what God called me to do. Many morning, 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, standing at an altar, feeling like I had been totally destroyed and shredded, crying, God, please do something. And all the time, God was waiting on me and my stubborn self. Tribulation. I'm going to have to skip down because, my Lord, I've done. Then there were blasphemy. There were those that would blaspheme the Christians at Smyrna. The Jewish unbelievers hated Christians and did everything possible to destroy their reputations. Those who hated these Christians used all sorts of malicious lies, gossip, and slander and innuendo to destroy the people in the eyes of others. Perhaps all of those who love the Lord have to endure their share of this kind of maltreatment. How many of us have been talked about? I've been talked about. There have been lies told on me. It's the enemy trying to undo your reputation. Now look, do you know how to best address that? Let me go ahead and hit this while I'm here. I am never going to get through this sermon. When somebody lies on you, when somebody spreads rumors about you, oh my Lord. When somebody tells false things about you, why don't we do what Jesus did when he was brought before Pilate? Button your lip and let your actions and let what you do speak for you, because actions speak way louder than words. And eventually those people will be found as the liars they are, and they will be found as the gossips they are, and you will have not a stoop to their level. You gain nothing by stooping down to another person's level. I know we want to. Oh my word, do I know we want to. You said what about me?
Oh no, you didn't.
We get the whole rattlesnake head going. I can't really do it. I'm kind of stiff in my old age. Y'all know you didn't. Stop it. It's time to be like the Lord. It's time to keep your mouth shut and allow God to work what he's working. Immediately, the Lord paints the enemies of the believers in a terrible plight. They that are guilty of these actions are literally members of the synagogue of Satan. What an oxymoron. Here is a place that many would recognize as a church, but it has become a literal living zone of a bunch of demons. You ain't doing yourself no good by talking about somebody because they talked about you. Oh, she said that? Well, she ugly. What about that? You ain't doing nothing with that mess. Right. You ain't. She stinks. She ain't had a bath in a week. Stop it. He walk around with a booger hanging out his nose all the time. I don't know what he's trying to call out. Stop. You're not helping anything by doing that. People who do that, the word said they were the synagogue of Satan. When you're tearing down somebody, you are not Christian. When you are tearing, let me say that just one more again. When you are tearing somebody down, that is not being a Christian, and the Lord is far from you. We are called to build people, to edify people. The Bible tells us to think on things that are good, that are lovely, that are just, that are pure. You ain't thinking on that when you're talking about somebody. You need to work on, you need to build them up. What they need to hear is an encouraging word. You don't need to beat them up with your words. Chances are that that's how they got where they are, because they've been beat up over and over and over again. Lord, I don't know why I'm there, but here I am. Does this same thing happen today? Absolutely does. How could a church evolve into a place where it becomes the synagogue of Satan when it becomes choked with worldliness, sin, false doctrine, and apathy toward the things of the Lord? That's how it gets there. When you understand the word of the Lord, you understand that everything that we do should be out of love, and everything should be done in Jesus' name. Good word right there, Brother Cooley. You speak that. And then he gives them a commandment in chapter 2, verse 10. I've got 5 minutes. I'm not going to get through this. For none of these things which thou shalt suffer, behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days, and be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. As with all the other churches, the Lord would have some directions to give to the churches. Smyrna was commanded to do some things in the face of difficult persecution that they would face. Fear none of those things. Prison is in your future. Trial and tribulation is in your future. Fear none of these things. Why? Because the Lord has his perfect plan for your future. We can know that the Lord has a limitation on evil. God will only allow the devil to go so far, and he knows what we can handle, and he is going to deliver you when the time is necessary. Don't you get upset with God's timing. He's working something out of you. We know that we can depend on a courage that comes from another world. There's times where I've been able to step up with courage that I know I did not possess myself. I can remember knocking doors one time, and there was a whole herd of gangbangers in Covington, and I walked right in the middle of it and invited them to ride the church bus to church. That was some, I don't know if that was dumb or just courage, but it was something. But I walked away from it. God will give us courage in the face of adversity. And the Lord will have the last word in every evil conflict. When people come against you and they speak ugly words, the Lord gets the last word. I know that there's some that says that this advice, just to be still, is kind of awful. Just grit your teeth and hope for the best. That's certainly not the way that we should look at this, but we have to have enough confidence in God that we cannot fear what we are facing, no matter where the difficulties come from, because the Lord's command is to fear none of those things. People talk about you, don't be afraid of it. Don't be angry. Well, be angry and sin not. That's a scripture that's going to be on my tombstone. Be angry and sin not. And even if the devil would choose to send some to prison, fear not and be faithful. If the devil could cause the Sabians and the Chaldeans to violence against Job, the devil can control the jailers and the civil authorities to come against the church. Luke 22 and 31 said this: Satan hath desired to sift you as wheat. In 1 Thessalonians 2 and 18, Paul desired to come to Thessalonica, but Satan hindered him. In 2 Thessalonians 2 and 9, with all power and lying wonders did the devil work. In Ephesians 6:11, we're admonished to stand against the wiles of the devil. And it goes on in verse 12 to let us know that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. The person talking about you, the person that's doing evil against you, that's not who's really working, but it's spiritual wickedness. They're just being a vessel because they're weak. You don't need to get angry with that person. You need to get angry with the spirit, and you need to go to prayer on that thing. Right. Clap your hands to the Lord. We must come to an understanding that we are in a spiritual war zone. I know that's not a hot topic. I was listening to a song the other day, and the singers of the song at the end, the guy's trying to ad-lib and be real cool with his little coffee house mentality, and he says, yeah, I know that we talk about spiritual warfare and all this kind of stuff, but isn't it great when we just sing the praises of God? No, it's not all this stuff. Spiritual warfare is real, and it goes on every day, and we must understand that unless we're praying, unless we're fasting, then we do not have what we need to win this war. Hallelujah. We also must know that the Lord sets a limit on our trouble. Okay, Revelations 2:10 and 11. But be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcomes shall not be hurt of the second death. The connection with being faithful is always going to be rewarded by a crown that will last forever. Throughout the Bible, there are a host of crowns that are given to those who are faithful. There's a crown of glory given for a faithful pastor in 1 Peter 5, 2-4. Thank you, Jesus. A crown of righteousness for those who live a godly life in 2 Timothy 4 and 8. A crown of life for those who are faithful in testing, James 1 and 12. A crown of rejoicing for those who win people to the Lord, 1 Thessalonians 2:19 and 20. An incorruptible crown for those who subdue their bodies and keep them under control and finish their course for the glory of God, 1 Corinthians 9:24 through 27. A child of God looks at suffering in a totally different light than a pagan unbeliever does. For the saint who suffers, tribulation will lead to triumph, and out of persecution becomes a prize, and out of death we will come to reign. Clap your hands to the Lord.